morning. Welcome to Trading Hour. I'm Reema Tendulkar. With me is Sumaira Abdi. Good morning, Sumaira. We were showing resilience once again in the morning, and the hope was that the Indian markets would continue their decoupling, continue to do better than the global markets. But again, in the last 1 hour, we've seen the selling pressure intensify. Currently, as we speak, the markets are down close to about 0.8, 0.9% on the benchmark indices. The Nifty is trading below its 200-day moving average. Some of the key levels to watch will be the 100-day moving average as well as Friday's low. Both of them coincide around that 17,620 to 16,750. These would be the key levels in terms of a support for our markets. Let's see whether we can hold on to that. Right now, as we speak, pressure is seen in many of the commodities. So Hindalco is one of the big losers, down close to about 3-odd%. Auto stocks, despite good numbers in terms of auto sales, are seeing some profit booking. So cuts, deep cuts coming through for Eicher Motors, Maruti. IT stocks were outperforming last week on the back of rupees depreciation. But today, you can see deep cuts coming through for HCL Tech as well as Tata Consumer. From next week onwards, all the IT companies will be reporting their numbers. And today, they are a bit subdued. On the gaining side, ONGC on the back of the gas price revision, that's higher, while Pharma continues with its outperformance. Divi's Cipla gaining close to about 1.7%. Hi.
Hi, Reema. Morning. So let's get started. We have our first guest joining in, the management of Gokaldas Exports. The rupees depreciation, falling cotton prices, festive season are all expected to benefit apparel exporters. Also, the news here is that the promoter entity Clear Wealth Consultancy has sold about 15 lakh shares to the Abu Dhabi Investment Authority. So to discuss all of this and more, we are joined by Sivaramakrishnan Ganpati, the Managing Director of Gokaldas Exports. Hi, sir. Morning. Thanks very much for joining in. First, just a word on this sale of shares by your promoter entity. Is there any reason for it?
No, not really. In fact, the promoter holds a significant share of the company, and they continue to strongly believe in the company. When ADIA came and looking for a stake in the company, the promoters were generous in letting them have some stake so that we could improve or increase the number of institutional shareholders in our portfolio and bring on board a valued internationally renowned investor in our portfolio of investments. That's the point. Nothing beyond that need to be read in it.
But the promoter holding has been coming down, sir. In June of 2021, the promoter stake was 33.1%. In June of 2022, it was down to 23.5%. So that's nearly a 10% decline in the promoter holding. And now again, you've sold some stake, which Abu Dhabi Investment Authority has bought. So can you talk a little bit more about the longer term, plan? Are the promoters willing to sell more stake? If, say, a marquee investor comes in, wants to buy stake in Gokaldas Exports, are they willing to let it go, promoter stake, come down from current levels?
I don't think, there is any room for that kind of a speculation. The promoters are pretty strongly, solidly behind the company. And, clearly, they have benefited from their investment in the company and continue to believe in the prospects of the company. So I don't think any of that is on the cards as of now.
Adya want more stake?
I'm sorry, say that again.
Does Adya, Abu Dhabi Investment Authority, want more stake in Gokaldas?
I wouldn't be able to comment on it.
Okay. Mr. Ganpati, let's talk about now the opportunity for textile makers like yourself. China and Vietnam are plagued by, rising costs, where there is Sri Lanka, also Pakistan are concerned. There are a lot of macro headwinds over there. So what is it, what does it spell in terms of, the market for you? Have you seen some orders which were going to countries like this now start flowing to India? And specifically for your own company, what is the opportunity?
So the opportunity is huge for the textile sector in India at large, and specifically for a well-performing company like Gokaldas, the opportunity is massive. So we have seen orders which were hitherto being placed in markets like China and Vietnam coming to India, more so from China. The reason is that the cost structures in China have gone up pretty significantly. Labor availability is a challenge, and increasingly United States is imposing a lot of curbs on imports from China. Tacit and implicit. So there is a definitely a move amongst large brands buyers from to move their sourcing to other larger countries which can step up and support that drop in volume, and India figures highly on it. For example, if you look at the US imports in the last 1 year, share of India has increased by 1%, while share of China has dropped by 2%. So, you know, half of China's drop has been picked up by India in that sense. So India is definitely gaining, and we are seeing a lot of business coming, you know, from China, indeed.
Will you be able to quantify that, the increased opportunity, or how much of that incremental business you've managed to get out of China as well as other countries like Vietnam where there are troubles?
No, so I don't want to quantify that, but, you know, good, because there's a lot of, you know, growth, you know, macroeconomic factors. So, you know, to parse all of that and ascribe a certain percentage only to China becomes very difficult. But we have seen a pretty reasonably good inflow coming in from China.
So exports is what percentage of your sales, and how much can it go up to if you are seeing increased demand?
So exports is about 90% of the sale, and the other 10% goes to the Indian arm of international brands. So we only deal with international customers, and exports form a vast majority of what we sell.
How much cheaper is the same product to be shipped out of India versus China? You said that costs in China have escalated. What would be the like-to-like comparison now?
Say that again. What is like-to-like meaning for India?
I'm saying if I want to make the same manufacture a product in India and ship it out of India versus the same product which is going to be manufactured in China, what's the price differential now?
Oh, so China would be at least 30-40% more expensive. But, you know, large brands typically tend to look at China for products which have the fabric sourcing from China. So there are certain products which cannot be manufactured in India simply because we lack the capability of sourcing those kind of fabrics, or it will increase the lead time. But otherwise, you know, China would be much more expensive than India.
So, Mr. Ganpathy, would you, you know, what is the capacity at right now? Would you need to add more? I mean, considering that, you know, you expect an influx of orders.
So, you know, capacity addition is way of life for us, you know, especially, you know, for companies which are performing well. In fact, we have CAPEX underway as we speak this year, which will mature by end of this financial year or early next quarter. That's our NITS unit. Our garmenting unit will also get commissioned by end of this calendar year. So we'll start operational from next quarter, that's fourth quarter. And we have more CAPEXs planned next year. So the CAPEX plan is as per schedule. Between FY23 and FY24, we intend spending about 280 crores. And that plan is as going as per schedule.
What percentage of your exports come in from UK or EU? And is there any slowdown there?
So the exports to European Union plus UK put together is about 4% of our revenue. So it's very small. Our exposure is very small. United States is a large part of our market or our exports portfolio.
Right.
Increasingly, with FTA coming up with UK, we expect that our business with UK may go up going forward in the future.
So particularly for US then, many of the retailers have cautioned their Target, Walmart, on account of high inflation. They're saying they're stuck with products of last year because of shipment delays, etc. And they are sitting on very high inventory. That would mean a big risk for a company like Gokaldas, right? Could you talk a little
bit
more?
Okay. Sure. Not really, because if you look at the top markets globally, you know, United States, Europe, and then China would be the top three markets. US has been a very resilient market. If you look at the sales figures, both, you know, retail sales and online sales, YTD July, that is January to July 22, sales has been higher than that of 21. So the market has been resilient. The consumers have been buying and sales growth has been reasonably good. The holiday season sales is to be watched, and I hope that that also remains resilient so that the whole year 22 ends up positive over 21. The inventory problem which you referred to, continues to be a problem, but it is a much lesser problem now than what it was, say, 4 months ago. So many of the large brands indicated that they're sitting on piles of inventory thanks to the supply chain problems of last year when they ordered much more. And since the supply chain has eased up, over this year, we have seen that excess inventory landed up in their warehouses. But over the last few months, many of the brands have started liquidating those inventories, and the inventory position is better than what it used to be about 3 to 4 months back, and it's improving as we speak. So I don't see that as too much of a problem or too much of a red flag at the moment.
Okay, Mr. Ganpati, thank you very much for joining in. We'll, of course, need to touch base with you again in a few months to find out how things are going. But for the moment, thanks for your time. A quick break for now. Up next, we'll talk about what's buzzing in the commodity space, and joining in will be Manisha Gupta. Hi, welcome back. You're with Trading Hour. Over to Manisha now, who's joining in to talk about what's happening in the commodity complex. And the focus today is on crude. Hi, Manisha. Morning.
Morning, and thank you so much for that, Samira. Yes, we've seen a strong rebound in crude prices, up nearly 2 to 3% on the screens right now. And this is because the US dollar index has declined from its 20-year highs. You also have the OPEC and allies meeting on 5th of October with an expectation that this would be the first time in the last 3 years that you could be looking at an output cut to the tune of 0.5 million to 1 million barrels per day. Until now, the OPEC and allies only have been increasing production to ensure that the supplies are restored back and the prices are contained. But with the kind of decline that we've seen in prices, especially for the month of September, where the prices fell by nearly 7%, they're down by nearly 20% in the previous quarter. OPEC and allies are now going to cut output yet again to see that the prices remain supported. Apart from that, it is also about the European Union ban on Russia, which takes place in this quarter itself on 5th of December. There is some premium that's coming back in the prices because of that as well. The markets do believe that with the kind of data that we've seen come in from China, where the manufacturing activities actually expanded versus expectation of contraction for the month of September, that could also be one of the factors that could be supportive into the markets. The range that the markets are looking at as of now clearly is between $85 to $95 per barrel on the higher side as well.
Okay, Manisha, thank you very much for that. We'll slip into a very short break, but with the recent 5G launch, we will be joined by Dayanand Mittal, research analyst at JM Financials, to talk more about the telecom sector. Welcome back. The much-awaited 5G rollout in India began on Saturday, with the telecom majors promising to deliver affordable 5G services across the country by as early as this Diwali. Listen in to what they had to say.
As an industry, we will ensure that we have the highest quality and the most affordable rates that anyone else has in the world. Today, I want to reiterate Jio's commitment to deliver 5G to every town, every taluka, and every tehsil of our district by December of 2023.
मैं आपको यकीन दिलाना चाहता हूं कि भारती के सब लोग और एयरटेल के सब लोग पूरे जोर से पूरी अपने हिम्मत से 5G को देश में फैलाएंगे और 2023 मार्च तक काफी शहरों में और 2024 मार्च तक सारे देश में 5G का फैलाव करेंगे और आज जहां जब आप लॉन्च करेंगे इस 5G को तो 8 शहरों में आज 5G एयरटेल की तरफ से उपलब्ध होगा दिल्ली वाराणसी मुंबई बेंगलोर और कई शहरों में
We will soon begin the 5G rollout journey. We will leverage our strong presence in rural India, our enterprise customers, our technology partners, and the global experience of the Vodafone Group for progressively rolling out our 5G networks and services in the coming period. Today, we are greatly honored that our beloved Prime Minister will soon launch the VI 5G use case demonstration.
Okay, that is the telecom majors detailing their rollout plans. For Reliance Jio, they're planning to have a pan-India presence by December 2023. Bharti will have a very good coverage across India by March 2023, which basically means 18 months from now. But Vodafone Idea has said that they will be launching and rolling out 5G very soon. But the statement lacked any specifics. We're now joined by Dayanand Mittal of JM Financial Institution Securities on the show now. Dayanand, that is the big question, right? There is still lack of clarity, no specific details coming out of Vodafone Idea. And do you think this is going to accelerate revenue market share loss for Vodafone Idea? It's been losing subscribers every month now, practically for so long now. But now if it's not offering 5G, whereas its peers are offering 5G, do you think it stands to lose some of those premium subscribers? And what's the impact? What's the outlook of Vodafone Idea according to you now?
Thanks, Rima. Thanks for having me. Yes, you are correct. Vodafone Idea, as you know, right now they're struggling even to meet the capex requirement for 4G. So their capex requirement at about 6,000 to 10,000 crore annually is 1/4 or even lower than what Jio and Bharti spending annually. And for 5G, it's a high capex business. Reliance has already announced a capex of over 2 lakh crores, and Bharti would be also upwards of 1 lakh crore. So Vodafone Idea, given they're struggling to finalize their debt fundraise, equity raise is probably a bit difficult in this scenario. So with that, I think just meeting the capex of 4G itself would be the key focus area in the interim. 5G maybe more of a focus area sometime next year, and this would accelerate the decline in subscriber base, particularly on the high ARPU segment, which are likely to move to 5G. So they would move out to peers like Bharti and Jio unless they kind of jack up their capex.
Do you have any estimate for what the revenue market share is going to look like? I think for Vodafone Idea, the revenue market share is down to 18%. For Bharti Jio combined, it's close to 75-76%. What are your own estimates?
Yeah, so assuming they don't go very aggressive on 5G, which looks likely to be the base case, their revenue market share is going to decline by another 300 to 400 basis points in our view over the next 2 to 3 years when a large part of the country will move towards 5G. And telecom being a high operating leverage business, fall in revenue and subscriber market share below the 20% trajectory makes it very difficult for you to then sustain the business in the long term. So that's going to be a key challenge. They need to get this fundraise done quickly. Though we still believe this 20,000 crore fundraise, even if they get it through, will be very limited given the higher capex requirement in 5G. So outlook looks very difficult for Vodafone Idea, I would say. But still, let's see how the fundraise goes through.
Okay, so you're anticipating a 300 to 400 basis points of a revenue market share loss for Vodafone Idea in the next 2 to 3 years, as things currently stand. What's the outlook for Indostars? Just last week, they sent a very stern letter to Vodafone Idea saying, pay up your dues or we will cut coverage and service to Vodafone Idea. If one of their biggest tenants, which contributes about 30 or a third of it, to the overall revenues, outlook is still unclear, what does this mean for Indostars?
Yes, you're right. One of the two tenants that Indus has in most of its towers is Vodafone Idea, the Wing Party. So if they were to lose out that, that would have a huge impact on their earnings, given, again, it's a high operating leverage business. So everything hits the bottom line. And hence, our estimates and target price also see a sharp cut if you assume we move towards a duopoly scenario. So right now, our target price about 240 assumes a 75% probability that Vodafone survives and a 25% probability that Vodafone the tenancy of Vodafone might get lost over the next few years. So in that scenario, target price drops to about 140 odd. So yeah, so the outlook is kind of uncertain for Indostars, and that's the reason we have a hold rating given. There's still limited clarity whether Vodafone can sail through given the huge capex requirement.
So this target price of 140 on Indostars assumes that Vodafone Idea does not exist at all?
Yeah, this is a bear case scenario, assuming a 100% duopoly scenario. Our target price of 240 is based on a 75% duopoly scenario.
Okay.
Assuming Vodafone survives, then the target price could be significantly above 240.
And how does the, but Vodafone Idea, even if it survived, has been consistently weakening, right? So in that context, what is the graded decline that we should expect in Indostars?
Yeah, but on the other hand, we also look at that with 5G coming in, there's huge requirement of towers that will come from Bharti, maybe also from Jio down the line. So on one hand, 5G is a good thing which is happening from Indus Towers perspective. But on the other hand, it's partly getting offset by a decline in Vodafone related towers.
This draft telecom bill has also simplified the framework for merger, demerger, acquisition or other forms of restructuring. They've allowed the government to provide relief to financially stressed telcos in cases of payment default in extraordinary circumstances. What are the implications for Vodafone Idea in particular?
Yeah, so at least the draft bill gives government the liberty to waive off or partially defer the dues for stressed telcos for a greater public good to maintain connectivity of services. So given, as we discussed earlier, the debt that Vodafone Idea has, about almost 1.9 lakh crore plus, looks difficult to get serviced based on given the current declining subscriber profile. So there's some expectation that there would be some relief which would be required from the government even going forward to make this a sustainable telco. So at least the government has provided provision to do that in case it's required down the line. They don't need any relief at least for next 3 years given the moratorium that we have. But after 3 years, there might be again a scenario where they would have to depend on government's relief to sustain thereafter. So at least a provision has been created by the government via this draft bill.
What, according to you, is the reason why the government is not converting the interest on the AGR dues into equity? It's been pending since January of 2022. And if the government, you know, has been very vocal about saying that it wants healthy market competition in the sector, they want three private players. And if they do not convert, then it's harder for Vodafone Idea to raise that external funding, which is needed for 5G rollout. So what, according to you, is holding the government back? What's the reason for the delay?
What we understand is there is a SEBI regulation which requires that the current market price of Vodafone Idea needs to be above the fair value of 10 rupees because the conversion can't happen below 10 rupees. So for that to happen, the CMP should be greater than 10 is what we understand. So current market price of Vodafone is below that level.
So you already agreed upon a conversion price, right? Of I think 11 rupees 80 paise.
Yeah, so once it goes above that fair value, then the government might take the final call to do that conversion. Otherwise, most of the approvals are in place.
No, my point is that the government has already agreed on a conversion price, right, of 11 rupees 80 paise. So that's independent of where the stock is currently trading at.
Yeah, but the SEBI regulations require that government conversion can't happen at above CMP. So the CMP needs to go to above that conversion price to go through. This is to protect government's finances, given it's a public money.
Okay. Thank you, Dayanand, for joining in. We look forward to chatting with you more when the Q2 numbers start trickling in and what the expectations are. But we're out of time right now. Get into a short break. We'll come back and discuss market technicals. Gaurav Ratnaparkhi of Sher Khan joins in with his top technical trading ideas.
Hi, welcome back to Trading Hour. Gaurav Ratnaparkhi of Sher Khan joins in now for a quick tech check on the market. Hi, Gaurav. Thanks very much for joining in. We've moved off of the lows, but still continuing to trend in the red. So what is the trade now on the index and what are your individual stock picks?
Yeah, good morning. So basically, in the case of Nifty, today's dip is actually a buying opportunity from short-term trading perspective. On Friday, we saw smart recovery in Nifty, which resulted in a bullish outside bar as well as an engulfing bull candle on the daily chart. And if we see the price action for the penultimate two sessions, that is on Wednesday and Thursday, then the angle of descent was decreasing on the hourly chart, and that was coupled with a positive divergence on the hourly chart. So the index was gearing up for a bounce back, and we did get so on Friday's session. Also on the higher time frame, we can see Nifty is getting support near 20-week moving average, and from there it has started this pullback. So today's dip is actually a part of that pullback process, and that can continue in the next few sessions. So we are not expecting any runaway rally from current level, but a bounce towards 17,200, 17,300 looks very much possible. With that, Nifty can fill up a gap area which was created recently during the decline. So from trading perspective, a dip towards 17,000 will be a buying opportunity. Keep a stop loss below 16,900, and on the higher side, 17,200 and 17,300 will be the short-term targets to watch out for. And in terms of individual stock trading ideas, I have picked up two on the long side. First one from the pharma space. Pharma space is witnessing strong traction since last week, and the positive action is likely to continue in this week and the coming sessions as well. So I have picked up Glenmark Pharma. This particular counter did not participate in the pharma rally recently, but it is now set to catch up on the way up. It has broken out from a consolidation today. The Bollinger Bands have started expansion. Even the Delhi Momentum Indicator has started a new cycle on the upside. So short-term trading perspective, this is a good setup to initiate fresh long position at current level. Keep a stop loss below 389 and target will be around 200-day moving average, which is around 425, 427. And the next one is Avenue Supermart, DMart that is. Basically, this stock was witnessing muted action for last couple of weeks. But basically, it was preparing for the next move on the upside. It was getting ready to resume its larger uptrend. It was forming a nice base near the junction of 40-day exponential moving average and Delhi lower Bollinger Band. And that base formation now looks complete. In the last session, the stock formed an inside bar pattern on the Delhi chart. And today, it has broken out on the upside. So it seems that the next move on the upside is on the cards. The Delhi momentum indicator has also given a fresh buy signal. So buy at current level with stop loss at 4330 and target will be 4700.
Thank you very much, Gaurav, for joining in. There's a pretty good rebound that we are seeing currently. The Nifty has recovered 100 points from the day's low. The mid-cap index is back in the green with a gain of 0.2%. And this ties in with the recovery that we're seeing across the global markets. The Dow futures is currently up more than about 100 points. And the buying is seen across large stocks in the last 15 minutes. So Bajaj Twins, Bajaj Finance, Bajaj FinServ have now raised to a near 1% gain. Bharti Airtel is seeing buy. That's added close to about 1.25%. L&T is another stock which is higher in trade. Tech Mahindra, a couple of these IT names. Titan Industries is very fast trimming its losses as well. So we're well off the early, you know, the lows that we were about just 30 minutes ago. Get into a break. On the other side, we'll discuss market fundamentals. Rakshit Ranjan, a Marcellus Investment Manager, joins us next. Welcome back. Let's talk about market fundamentals. Rakshit Ranjan, Portfolio Manager at Marcellus Investment Managers, now joins in. Rakshit, morning. While you don't select stocks based on the index levels, you do watch it. What's happening in the global markets and the impact, the rub-off in the Indian markets. What have you made of the turmoil that we are seeing in the US markets, in Europe, and India's resilience?
Yeah, sure. So I think there are two or three things that we keep observing. One, India being a far more domestic economy, both on the demand as well as to an extent on the supply side, rather than significant global connections in order to run the economy. So to that extent, there is resilience. There is a little bit of less impact from the global macro. But also there are two very significant offsetting factors that we see in the listed universe. One, the China plus one story or shifting of a lot of economic activity towards India from some of the other economies in the B2B sectors, etc. That's I think, a very big a tailwind to some companies that are benefiting from it, which is an offset against the adverse global macro. Secondly, in the last 2 years, there have been too many opportunities to deploy capital in ways that you could not have deployed in a normal environment and thereby upgrade the sort of prospects of free cash generation over the next 3 to 5 years. That's a very big offset. When you combine these two together, I think the importance of global macro reduces, particularly in the way we look at things here to pick up stocks.
Okay. Hi, Rakshit. Morning. So what are the sectors which are looking attractive right now? I mean, are there, I'm sure there are pockets where things are looking good. So what is it that is appealing to you?
Yeah, so, but particularly, I think the theme rather than the sector, I would call it, the theme that looks attractive to us is where a lot of IT investments and tech investments have been done by businesses in the last 2 or 3 years, both at the front end or the back end as in manufacturing, et cetera. Front end would be on the distribution sales side. These tech investments are actually transitioning some of the companies from being traditional businesses to new age businesses, quote unquote, right? And that's a massive theme which interests us. At the same time, there are a few tailwinds as an offshoot of the macro where competitive intensity used to be high when the money was freely available to private equity, venture capital funded companies, etc. And now, since those funding taps have started to dry up a little, competitive intensity has actually become a lot more rational rather than irrational. And hence, when you combine these two or three things together, the theme that emerges then is a set of companies which are incredibly favorably affected by the external environment these days.
Would you like to name some of these companies?
Well, quite a few. I mean, so take some of the examples from, let's say, our portfolio and all of these companies we, our families, our clients are invested in. So Bajaj Finance has transitioned very meaningfully over the last 2-3 years from a traditional lender towards a lot more fintech than it was previously. There are companies such as Page Industries, Pidilite, where the front end distribution was the traditional manual intervention till 2-3 years ago. And today it is fully automated. I mean, auto replenishment systems and demand forecasting, the way they're working, it's no less than a pure tech-based company would be operating in some of those attractive sectors. And say, let's look at companies such as Asian Paints. The kind of work that they're doing on home decor, right, is something which is transitioning the business's growth prospects in future. So these are things that Dr. Lal PathLabs acquiring Suburban and sort of growing Invest. This is the capital allocation which otherwise would not have happened in a normal environment at such a rapid pace.
But Rakshit, you know, most of these, if not all, are these large caps. Aren't you venturing into the mid cap space? So, you know, isn't there enough opportunity there?
So there are. So whether you look at large, mid or small, the opportunities that we see are with companies that are, that have already got established dominance, and on that on the back of that dominance, they're leveraging onto these investments, these capital allocation disciplines. So rather than sort of finding such opportunities in companies which were the fourth largest or fifth largest in the sector and might become the largest in future, that's not the mid cap that we are finding attractive. The mid cap we're finding attractive is sort of businesses which are mid-cap just because they are dominant in relatively smaller sectors, but following the same theme.
The correction, the recent correction that we've seen, or the volatility that we've seen, has also given you a lot of opportunity to load up on your favorite stocks. Can you tell us some of the recent purchases, say, in the last 1 or 2 months?
Yeah, sure. So about a month ago, we loaded up on Divi's Labs. Early last month, we loaded up on Divi's Labs. And again, disclaimer, so Divi's is in our portfolio, our families, our clients. We have a significant exposure. So Divi's Labs was one where we loaded up because there were concerns which we thought were a little more short-term oriented, which were bringing the share price down, and that created an opportunity. 2-3 months ago, it was Titan, where there was, I think, government's gold import duty increase, customs duty on gold import was increased, and the share price took beating. So every time we see such opportunities, we load up on that. Having said that, I think in the last 3-4 months, the volatility for high quality businesses is share price. Share prices has been a lot lower than the broader market, unlike what was happening in the first 6 months of this calendar year.
So anything in the mid-cap space?
Yeah, in the mid-cap space as well, I mean, continue to be very, very upbeat about companies such as, say, GMM Pfaudler, and Alkyl Amines, Page Industries, even Berger, right? These are the mid-caps that that we're quite excited about. And again, disclaimer, heavily exposed to all.
Any stocks, new stocks, which are on your watch list as potential entrants into your consistent compounders list? And can you tell us a little bit more about that?
Yeah, so can't name those stocks until we end up buying them. It'll be unfair to our clients in case we end up buying them in future. But yes, the pipeline is a lot healthier today than it was, say, 2 years ago. And the reason for that is, to begin with, think of it like this. In the last 12 to 18 months, the kind of churn that we've seen in our existing portfolios in terms of entry exits, right, of stocks is a little higher than the churn that we've seen over the longer term in a normal environment. And the reason for that, again, is that many companies which otherwise were not able to capitalize on too many opportunities, have found many of those ways to capitalize on opportunities in the last 2-3 years, whether it be through acquisitions, through tech investments, through benefiting from some of the macro themes that are playing out, etc. So yes, the pipeline of new stocks has become healthier, longer than it was till 2-3 years ago.
All right, Rakshit, thanks very much for your time today and for taking us through your outlook for the market. By the way, the Dow futures recovered. And with that, we also bring you great news for investors, because if you're looking to track the U.S. market action real time, all you have to do is log on to the Money Control website or app and stay informed about all that matters in the global market. Hi, welcome back to Trading Hour. Let's now take a deep dive into the credit card market in India. Abhishek Kothari is joining in with an explainer of all the major trends in terms of spends, market share, and also what to look forward to.
Well, credit card issuance growth rate for the month of August on a month-on-month basis has declined. And this decline has come for the first time in the last 14 months. HDFC Bank continued to gain market share in spends. The reclassification from RBI led to card issuance numbers being down, especially for the likes of HDFC Bank and Axis Bank. Now, credit card issuance on a month-on-month basis has declined for the first time in the last 14 months, down about close to 2.8% month-on-month. So, there is an RBI ruling to not classify those cards which are inactive in terms of 12 months or more, so in total number of cards. Hence, primarily, it looks like it has taken a toll on some of the players. So, card issuance on a month-on-month basis was strong for the likes of DBS India, Federal Bank, South Indian Bank, AU Small Finance Bank, and IDFC First Bank. While it was weak for the likes of Canara Bank, Axis Bank, HDFC Bank, Bank of America, Bank of India, as well as Yes Bank. Overall spends for the industry have declined by 3% month-on-month. Spends per card, however, have declined by just 0.2% month-on-month, and it remains below May average by about close to 2.5% to 2.6%. Let's take a look how the market share in terms of spends have moved over the last 6 months. So in spends, HDFC Bank has gained market share in last 6 months, while SBI Card has arrested the declining trend for the first time in last 6 months. ICICI Bank has lost massive market share over here by almost 228 basis points month-on-month. So top four have seen their market share in spends decline from 74.5% that they had in April 2022 to right now about 73.3% that they saw in August 2022. Market share loss in spends over the last 6 months is seen for the likes of SBI Cards, ICICI Bank and IndusInd Bank. Highest market share gain in spends over the last 6 months is seen for the likes of HDFC Bank, Kotak Mahindra Bank, as well as Bank of Baroda. So market share movement for HDFC Bank, it continues to remain the leader over here with a market share of close to 28-29%. And HDFC Bank has been able to gain massively in terms of market share over the last few months. This followed by Axis Bank as well as Bank of Baroda. However, on a declining trend, we have seen market share loss for the likes of SBI Card, ICICI Bank, as well as IndusInd Bank in terms of market share in spends. So the outlook in credit card business is that the decline in average spends, that continues to be a cause of worry, but it can pick up in the coming months owing to the festive season that we will witness. So RBI has also asked banks to reclassify the number of cards and remove the non-active cards or the cards which have not been active for 12 months. This has had its impact on some of the players like HDFC Bank, Canara Bank and Axis Bank. Card issuances can decline for some in the next couple of months due to this RBI diktat. HDFC Bank is gaining massively in spends market share over the last few months. With festive season coming up, we can expect spends for the industry as a whole to increase from current levels.
Thank you very much for that, Abhishek. With that, it's a wrap on Trading Hour. As we wrap up the show, we leave you with some important market opinion coming in from Kotak Mahindra AMC's Harsha Upadhyay. Thank you for watching the show.
I think India has been a bright spot in an otherwise challenged global economy, I would say. While we have done much better than most of the markets in the recent past, the trend also continues. But we need to remember that we can't be immune to the kind of volatility that is likely to be there in the global equity markets. Having said that, I would say that the problems at Indian economy is much lesser as compared to what you would see globally. For example, the negative real interest rates across the globe is much higher than what we are witnessing in India. So to that extent, the interest hikes that would be required in Indian economy would be a lot lesser. So the growth impact is going to be a lot lesser. Even after a couple of interest rate hikes, our economy has been resilient in terms of growth. In the last couple of months, we have increased our exposure to banking and financials. Within banking and financial, it's been mostly large banks, because that's where we believe, while on one side you are seeing credit growth picking up, you also won't have the pain of cost of funds going up, because there are reasonably strong CASA ratios across the board. Another pocket where we have been adding to has been autos, more particularly in the passenger vehicles. While we have some exposure to two-wheelers and commercial vehicles, but we do believe that the passenger vehicle segment is likely to see very, very strong growth. And some of the headwinds that we had seen in the past, for example, the chip shortage or the commodity cost pressures, etc., also seem to be kind of normalizing. So we do believe that these two segments can be our performers as we go ahead. Domestic inflows are a big cushion for our markets in terms of reducing volatility, I would say. But again, even here, we need to remember that last quarter, that's July to September, we have seen a bit of moderation, nothing alarming. The SIP numbers still continue to be growing on a month-on-month basis. We are at record levels now. That continues to be the long-term trend, which also is more sticky. So I would say that that quantum should continue giving a lot of support to the market. I really do not see a situation where domestic flows will turn into negative and that would put additional pressure to the market. That may not happen. But the kind of cushion that we were seeing for the entire October to June period, October of last year and June of this year, maybe a little bit is going down at this point of time.